Subscribe to our channel and press the bell icon to never miss any update. From Cradock.
Hello everyone, this is Swarit Dwivedi telling you all about chemistry for JEE Mains. So as we were discussing about JEE Mains 2016 chemistry question paper, I would like to continue our discussion about question number 51st, question number 60th. So let's start with the difficulty analysis first. About the difficulty level, so these set of questions are relatively, you know, on a tougher side, because most of the questions here are of medium level questions, right? So most of the questions here are medium level questions. One question is a tough question, and it's relatively tough question. It can consume a lot of time, and you know, again, about 40 to 50% of the questions are easy, on an easy side. Because in chemistry, what you generally have, if you know the question, you can directly answer the question and you can save a lot of time there. Right. So let's begin with the question analysis. Now, in this question, the reaction with propene, reaction of propene with HOCl, right? So what is propene? This is a structure of propene. So on the other side, if I'll draw this structure, so it will look something like this, right? So it is reacting with HOCl. What is this HOCl? Actually, in H2O you have H and OH, and in Cl you have two chlorine atoms. So what will be the intermediate if this HOCl reacts with this compound? What will be the intermediate in this case? That has been asked. So let's talk about this in this reagent first. What is HOCl? So in HOCl, what happens, this chlorine, because of this polar solvent, which is, you know, which is water, this chlorine bond is heterolytically, you know, fissioned. So a heterolytic fission of this bond will occur. So in that case, you will get Cl plus and Cl minus. Now in this case, what happens, this Cl minus will go with this H plus, right? This Cl minus will go with this H plus and forms HCl. And now you have two kinds of you know, files, like one is electrophile and one is nucleophile. You will have Cl plus and OH negative, right? So what happens, first of all, this Cl plus as a nucleophile will attack this double bond, right? And you will get an intermediate like this one, CH positive, and then this CH2, and then Cl will be here, right? And then this OH minus will come, and you know, will come as a nucleophile and attack here. So CH plus is an electrophile, in fact, and it attacks this carbon in search of electrons. It will take that pi electrons, and the, you know, nucleophilic center which has been developed here. So this nucleophile OH negative will then later attack here. So if you can see the options, you can see that D part tells you the same. So D part, this is the intermediate, right, which is formed in this reaction. Are you clear about the action of Cl2, H2O, HOCl, right? And then how the reaction proceeds. So the answer is D part. Moving on to the next question. So a 2-chloro-2-methyl-pentane, right? 2-chloro-2-methyl-pentane. So it's a pentane, right? 2, 3, 4, right? And it has CH3, 2-methyl, and a chlorine group, 2-chloro-pentane. On a reaction with sodium methoxide. So what is sodium methoxide? CH3O minus Na plus in methanol. So it is present inside methanol, CH3OH, yields. So what product does it yield? That has been asked in the question. So what happens in this case? First of all, this you know, this group, right, this group attacks as a, this is what, this is a nucleophile, right? So it attacks at this carbon, right, substituting chlorine. So here you'll get this structure. So your chlorine will leave the structure and chlorine will get combined with what? With sodium, right? Then again, it takes a H, right? It takes a H from the carbon, which is just as adjacent to the carbon it has been attached with. So what are those carbon? The alpha carbons, right? So this is alpha carbon. And what is this? It has one H and this also has one H. So what it tries to do, it tries to take out this H, right? And leave as CH3OH, okay, giving a double bond to this place. So it can take this H out or it can take this H out. So it has two options, to take this H out or to take this H out or to take this H out. It has eventually three options, to take either this H out or the, because it also has an alpha carbon and an alpha H. So how many kinds of structures are possible in this case? One is this, right? Another one is, one is this, another one is, you know, double bond here and methyl group here, and another one is this one. Now tell me one thing, right? Tell me one thing, aren't these two structures similar? Right, so these two structures are also similar. So one structure you get is of this kind and another structure you get of this kind, right? So these two you can see in your option, right? So this structure is of this kind, right? And this structure is of this kind. And you can see here this intermediate you also get during the reaction. So until and unless this, you know, OCH3 group leaves with a hydrogen, you had this compound as well. And although in major amount or minor amount, this will also be present there in some amount, right? So all three components will be there in this reaction mixture. So the compound does not vanish always. Even a little amount, but some amount will be there. So A part, like C part, that all of these are present is correct. Moving on to the next question. Which one of the following complexes, right, show optical isomerism? So what is optical isomerism here? Let's see. So let's see, because it will take a lot of time. So let's see the correct option first. Right, so what type of compound is this? So this En, right, it's a bidentate ligand, right? Bidentate ligand. So what does it do? So it will form a octahedral structure, right? Octahedral. If you show the, you know, the hybridization, you'll get to know that it will form a octahedral structure, right. So in this octahedral structure, this cobalt atom, right, so this one is present at the base, okay, and then in this octahedral, in this cis structure, what will happen? This En, right, will be present at the same side, okay, and chlorine will be at some other side. So what will be the mirror image of that structure? If I'll draw, you know, the square plane here, right? So what will be the mirror image of that structure? So if I'll draw the mirror image, so this is our mirror, and if I'll draw the mirror image of this structure, I'll get to know this structure will be again something like this one, right? So in this case, what happens? This En, right? This En will come here like this, right? And this En will come here like this. Now, if you just, if you just visualize this structure in, space and try to take these ion, right? This one. Take these two ions, right? And try to, rotate it, right? Try to rotate it in this way, okay? And try to put it over this your first compound. You will see that these two compounds will not exactly match. These two compounds will now not exactly match. So this way, this compound will show optical isomerism, right? This compound will show now optical isomerism. Moving on to the next question. Now, the main oxides formed on combustion of Li, right? Na and K in excess of air are. So, combustion, vigorous combustion means what? The reaction with Li, Na and sodium, right? Of what? O2. O2's reaction with Li, Na and sodium. What does happen? See, Li has a small size. Na has a bit larger side. And then potassium has a bigger side. So what happens in S group? What happens in the alkali metals, the first group? That the smaller size one forms a monoxide. Right? And then this the sodium one, which is of a bit bigger size, forms a pyroxide, right? And the last one, which is potassium, right? So the potassium will form which oxide? Superoxide. So in the monoxide case, what happens? This lithium is two lithiums are attached with oxygen, right? So this is having O2 negative, right? This pyroxide is Na2O2. So pyro bond means this oxygen will be attached to one oxygen and one bond will be left, right? So this will be O2 2 negative, right? And this superoxide means O2 negative, right? So this one will be clay, the lithium will be Li2O, sodium will be Na2O2 and your potassium will be KO2. Monoxide, pyroxide and superoxide. So which one is the correct option? B part. Let's move on to the next question. 18 gram glucose, right, is added to 178.2 gram of water. So what is the molecular weight of glucose? So molecular weight of glucose, your salt, which is A, right, is equals to 180 gram, right? And the weight of glucose is 18. On the other hand, the molecular weight of water, your B, solvent, is 18 gram, and your weight of water taken, wait, sorry, WB, right? WB taken will be 178.2 gram, right? So now the number of moles of A is 18 by 180. Number of moles of B is, 178.2 divided by 18, right? So now the vapor pressure of water, right? The vapor pressure of water in torr for this aqueous solution is, vapor pressure of water in torr for this aqueous solution is. So what will be the vapor pressure in this case? So what we'll do is here, in normal cases, the vapor pressure of water is 1 atm, right? 1 atm. And 1 atm means 760 torr, right? And when this kind of a solute is dissolved, right? So the vapor pressure has been lowered. So this question is related to relative lowering of vapor pressure. So what does that mean? So the new pressure P is equals to P naught times mole fraction of solvent, right? So the vapor pressure is P is equals to P naught times mole fraction of solvent, because in the case of relative lowering of vapor pressure, you get something like this. P minus P naught divided by P naught is equals to XA, right? But in terms of mole fraction of solvent, you get this thing. So now the vapor pressure is equals to normal vapor pressure, right, divided by the, you know, the mole fraction of this B compound. So what is the mole fraction of B? NB divided by NA plus NB, right? And which you get from this thing, right? What is NA and NA plus NB? So when you multiply this, you'll get 752.4 torr. So which option is correct here? Option number A part is correct, right? Moving on to the next question. So the reaction of zinc with dilute and concentrated nitric acid respectively produces, right? So now about the reaction of zinc with dilute and concentrated nitric acid. So let's talk about the nitric acid. So nitric acid can be, you know, in form of less concentration, which we call as dilute nitric acid, and concentrated nitric acid, right? So the dilute nitric acid, let's say it's present in 20%, you know, volume by volume nitric acid in a solution, and here it is like 70%. So what difference does it make that concentrated nitric acid is a very strong oxidizing agent? So what does it do that whenever zinc is being reacted with this dilute nitric acid, it forms zinc nitrate, that is fine, right? But it forms N2O, laughing gas, right? And apart from that, say H2O, right? If I'll you know, just try to balance this reaction, so this will be 4, then 10, then here it will be 4, here it will be 5, right? And in case of concentrated, you know, nitric acid, what happens that this zinc nitrate is forms, but the gas, right, is NO2 and then here H2O, right? So this gas which is formed is NO2. So I'm not pretty sure if the this is balanced properly, right? Because if your N is 2, right, so then this NO2 will be 2, right, and this hydrogen is 4, so I guess there should be a 2H2, but then again it does not make so much difference, right? So the gas which leaves, you know, the system, so in case of dilute acid, this NO2 leaves the system, and in case of concentrated acid, this NO2 leaves the system, in case of dilute N2O, right? And this happens because concentrated HNO3 is a strong oxidizing agent. Chal. Let's move on to the 57th question. What has been asked is about the rate of formation. See, so the decomposition of H2O2 follows a first order reaction, right? So what is the decomposition of H2O2? So here it should be when the concentration of this H2O2, right, this H2O2 reaches 0.5. So the decomposition, so first of all you have to know about the decomposition of H2O2. So the decomposition of H2O2 takes place something like this. So it will go into H2O plus, then it will form half times O2. Right, so now it's a first order reaction. First order reaction means d by dt of concentration of H2O2, right, is equals to d by dt of concentration of H2O according to the stoichiometric coefficients, right? Plus d by dt of concentration of O2. But here we have a stoichiometric coefficient as 1 by 2. So here 1 upon 1 by 2. Sorry, not plus. It is equal to. Right? And then it is equivalent to K times concentration of H2O2. Right? This is the basic rule. So minus times the, you know, the rate of change in concentration of the reactant is equals to plus times, you know, 1 by stoichiometric coefficient times d by dt of, means the rate of change of concentration of the reactants, right? So minus d by dt of CH2O2 is equals to d by dt of CH2O is equals to 1 upon 1 by 2 d by dt of CO2, concentration of O2, not CO2, right, is equals to K times, which is the, you know, the rate constant, times concentration of H2O2. Fine. So from here we get our rate law as K is equals to 1 by T, right, ln of concentration of A, like of H2O2, right, initially, maybe not, divided by concentration of H2O2 at present, right. So after 50 minutes, the concentration of H2O2 decreases from 0.5 to 0.125, right. So in 50 minutes, your concentration decreases from 0.5, the initial, to, right, to 0.125, right. So you will be having here 1 by 50 into, you know, if you just, you know, divide this thing, so you'll get 2 times ln 2. I've just applied some basic logarithm. So now you have the equilibrium constant. It has been asked when the concentration of H2O2 reaches 0.05, right, the rate of formation of O2 will be. So from this part of this equation, right, you can write the rate of formation of O2, which is d by dt of C, of C means concentration, right, C means concentration of O2, is equals to, see, from here you will get here 1 by 2 times K times the concentration of H2O2 at that point. So what is the concentration of H2O2 at the point which on at which this rate has been asked? 0.05, right? 0.05. And K, you just have found K, 1 by 2, right, times K, which is 1 by 50, right, times 2 ln 2 multiplied by 0.05. So what is ln 2? You know the value of ln 2, 0.693, right? And when you solve this whole thing, you'll get rate of change of concentration of O2 as 0.6.93 into 10 to the power minus 4, right? You can see here, 1 by 2 into 1 by 50, right, into 2 times 0.693 into 0.05, right? When you multiply it, it will become 100, right, 500, and then 5 will be cancelled out from here. So this will eventually become 10 to the power minus 3, this whole thing, right? This whole thing will become like that. So when you'll just try to calculate it, you will get to know, right, that it will come out to be as 6.93 into 10 to the power minus 4 mole per minute, right? So let's move on to the next question. Okay, fine. So the pair having the same magnetic moment, right? So here in this question, let's talk about the option which is correct here. So magnetic moment you can find, because because they just not they don't ask here the exact magnetic moment. What they ask is, you know, which two are having the same magnetic moment. So as you know that this magnetic, you know, this magnetic moment, right? So this is a function of number of free electrons in the orbits, right? Number of single free electrons in the orbits. So let's look at the option. So here in this option, this Cr is in plus 2 oxidation state, and this iron or Fe is in plus 2 oxidation state as well, because H2O is a neutral ligand, right? So let's talk about chromium. So in chromium, so let's talk about the configuration of chromium. It is something like what? Like this one, right? And in case of Cr 2 plus, right, again we'll be having, you know, this one is 4SR. So again we'll be having this electron and this electron less. We'll be having 4 single free electron. But in case of iron, again, case of iron, let's talk about this iron. So iron, so Cr has 24 atomic number, right? And this has 26. So in this case, what happens? 4, 5, 6 d electrons, right? So in this case, when you know you want to eject the two electrons, so these two will be ejected. So then again you are having how many number of free electrons? 4. And in case of chromium 2 plus also you have the number of free electrons as 4. So these two, you know, compounds or anions, you know, the cations will have the same number of free electrons, means the same magnetic moment. So D part is correct here. Let's move on. Now the galvanization is applied at a coating of. So this you have to know. This is very simple thing. So galvanization is always a coating of zinc, you know, and you do this coating of zinc over the iron rods, right, other street poles, or like the lots of things. You do this zinc coating to prevent those structures from rust, right? To prevent the structures from rust, you do the coating of zinc, and that thing is known as galvanization. And in our electrochemistry chapter, you must have studied about the, you know, electrogalvanization, in which, you know, this electrode potential of Zn 2 plus to Zn is something as minus 0.76. So you can coat this zinc easily, right? So this coating of zinc is known as galvanization. So which is the correct option here? B part is the correct option. So this is a direct question, right? Now move on to the last question. So here I guess some text is not visible here. So okay, so the wavelength, right, wavelength associated, right, so wavelength which is lambda associated with the electron, so it has been told that wavelength is lambda, right, with the electron wave, this one. So let's read the question first, right? So the stream of electrons from a heated filament is passed between two charged plates. So there are electrons, right, from a, you know, from a heated sort of, you know, so the source of electron is a heated filament. Obviously you'll get electron from some source, but that does not have so much significance there. So it just means that electron at the initial having no energy. Okay, when you keep them in between a plate having an electrode potential of V, so what you are doing, you are, you know, you are giving them an energy of E times V electron volt, because E is the charge on the electron. So that is the potential energy, the electrostatic potential energy. So what is the electrostatic potential energy? Q times the potential. So what is Q here? E is the charge on the electron, right? So E and M are the mass and charge on an electron respectively. So, you know, the value of what has been asked here, the value of h by lambda. So this is the complete question. So they have asked the value of h by lambda, and since we know this thing that h by lambda is equals to p, right? From a basic de Broglie relation and all, we know this thing that h by lambda is equals to p, right? Because your lambda is h by p. So h by lambda is equals to p. So your h by lambda value, which has been asked, is equivalent to the momentum, right? And what is momentum? P is equals to root 2 me, right? This thing you know, that me, because at the end when they will come here, all energy will be converted into the kinetic energy and so on, right? So P is equals to root 2 m times e. And what is that e? What is that energy? That energy, these electrons don't possess any energy from before, because they have been ejected by a heated filament. So the initial energy was zero. But all the energy which is present in those electrons is that electrostatic energy only, right? So this P is equals to 2 times m, right? 2 times m into electron volt, which is that E energy, right? So this is only your h by lambda. So what is the correct option here? B part, electron volt. This is the energy, root 2 times MeV, right? So this question also must be clear to you. So now I have told you all about the 2016 JEE mains chemistry examination. If you want to prepare a lot of model test papers, right, you want to get the complete notes of all the chapters, different, you know, about different compounds and, you know, the organic chemistry notes and the physical chemistry notes, and all about, you know, very interesting note about qualitative analysis and all, you can just download the Grade Up app from this Google Play Store, right? And you, in that, this app, you can discuss all your doubts with your fellow students and experts as well. So just, if you haven't already, just download the app from Google Play. This is Swarit Dwivedi signing off in this video. We'll in subsequent videos, we'll discuss the chapters and the conceptual subjects, as well as the, you know, the previous year JEE papers. So thank you so much. I hope that you like this video.